Look at me. Shake it like it's hot. I think it's dropping like it's hot.
This is Charles Koppelman. You're watching Star Power on the Whatever It Takes Network. Be there.
This guy, I think we might have lucked out. So I'm gonna go meet with legendary music producer. He's actually a singer, songwriter for some reason, even in print. And having had the privilege of working with Charles for a while, he's even quite shy about his acumen as a songwriter and musician. I'm gonna see if I can get him to cop to it. Well, I'm gonna trick him. I'm gonna play a video that I dug up online on YouTube of Charles singing as the lead of his band. You'll get a kick out of. Why I want you to hear from Charles is, Charles is one of the few people, and I'm gonna use a term and it sounds bad, Charles, don't hold this against me. He's a yes man. There's no no's. He picks up the phone. He's interested. He's saying yes first, and then he's figuring it out. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, then it doesn't. Charles is at the top of the entertainment heap because he understands one thing, and one thing very clearly. Relationships are the key to this business. This guy, just today alone, he's managing Nicki Minaj, J-Lo, Marc Anthony, Pitbull. There's no one bigger in the business and putting together the biggest deals, the Coles deal for J-Lo and Marc Anthony, the water bottle deal that Nicki has.
I think it's a wine cooler, the Nicki Minaj thing.
Yeah, is it a wine cooler?
Yeah.
I haven't had it. Have you had, did you have it?
No.
Yeah, me neither. And he's worked with the biggest, Barbara, Diana, Michael. It's insane, the list goes on and on. But he's also a really nice guy. And I don't know if it can be taught, but let's go talk to Charles and find out if we can learn something from him today. Charles.
Hank, how are you?
Good.
Good to see you.
How are you doing?
I'm doing great, thank you.
Thanks for having me.
My pleasure.
I wanted to start, I found some stuff that I wanted to run more, play some music for you just to see what you thought about it. Let's see if I can get this up. I found this very interesting. I can't wait to hear.
I saw a
coat. Yep.
Is that you?
That's me.
Like he should have been in bed.
I'm 19 years old.
I said, what gives, man? He looked at me and said,
I'm a yogi. Yogi baby.
I'm a yogi. Yogi baby.
How great is that?
Just for the fall that you love.
My mother said,
here's what's interesting to me, and in case you don't have an idea of what my show is about, so you know, I work with talent, and I help people come up with how to not just monetize, but how to get their word out so that that resonates with an audience. It's clear that you have a passion for music. I mean, you're singing. I've read before this interview, obviously, I read as much as I could about you, and we worked together, and I like you, and I knew about you anyway. You are a legend, as you'll see when we walk around. These walls are amazing. Yeah, I would love to talk about Michael.
Michael was, I actually worked with Michael for about 4 years.
People always told me, be careful what you do. Don't go around picking young girls' hearts. And mother always told me, be careful who you love. Be careful what you do. Get the love in your mind.
Did some work with Michael.
How does that happen? What's the reason to meet him?
The first time I met Michael, it really had to do, which was the late 90s, which had to do with Michael wanting to, and his advisors wanting to securitize a lot of his music publishing assets, and I had a little company at that time that did that. And then the second time, which ended up being a meaningful period of time where I reorganized his entire life.
Music's in your blood somewhere. You go on, you're online and in magazines is saying, I don't write music, I don't sing. That's why I read all that, and then I started digging more, and I'm like, here he is singing. He wrote this song, you came up with the hook, you're the lead singer.
I am.
And you continually say, I'm not a music guy.
The first thing, if you've read enough, you also know that I'm not necessarily that modest.
How do you go from, what makes you push to get on TV, to start a band? Where does that come from for you?
Pump up the jam, pump it up, while your feet are stumping.
Where does that come from for you?
So, my next door neighbor when I was growing up, boy was a friend of mine, his father was one of the editors of Cashbox magazine. So as I was growing up in my, 15, 16, 17, I would read these old copies of Cashbox. And somehow it obviously subliminally got into my brain that there was a business of music. And when my friends asked me to form this trio, and we had this trio, I said to them one day, why don't we go into the city and interview for audition for record companies. Went into Manhattan, we knocked on the doors, and ultimately these two producers heard us and said, we'll sign you. Now I went from writing songs and trying to get Kirshner to hear my songs to listening to Carol King.
I feel the earth move under my feet.
And Jerry Goffin songs and Barry Mann and Cynthia Weil and all these incredible writers, helping them with suggestions if I had them. And then when they would give me their demos of the song, I would go and get other artists to record those songs. And what I found that I knew how to do is, one, I knew how to edit songs because of my writing songs. And second, I found it easy to take a song and think of who that artist was going to be that should record it. And then to convince those people, those producers, those artists that they should do that song.
What else we got? Look at this. It's like it's an amazing, it's a who's who from popular, very popular. I know you worked with Arrested Development as well.
Tennessee.
Lord, I've really been real stressed. Down and out, losing.
Cats 2? Tons of Eddie, Barbara again, Diana. Dolly, I guess you know Dolly Parton really well.
Oh, Dolly's the greatest.
Here you come again. Oh, and looking better than a body has a right to.
Which ones would you say you're the most proud of? Where you that is the biggest pairing you made of the song, and you managed to wrangle the person, or was just
One of the earliest ones that was really a big win was the follow-up to "He's So Fine" by the Chiffons. And I had a song called One Fine Day that Carol King and Jerry Goffin wrote. And got a hold of the producers, Hank Medras and his partners, and convinced them, they listened to it, that should be the follow-up They then said to me, we'll do it, but we want to use the track, the music, that's on the demo. So I then had to get Jerry Goffin and Carole King to agree that. What I found early on is that I had this ability to recognize what a great song was and even change it a little bit if need be, and then translate that enthusiasm to someone who was looking to find a great song.
I'm also going to argue and augment your theory of you know a good song and then you still. I think you're humble and you claim you're willing to brag, so that I think it proves my point that you recognize talent and personality and then you build around that, which I think that's your skill and we can argue about that. But
I'm not going to argue with that.
Let's see this. This to me was.
Yo, VIP, let's kick it.
I think there's a picture of you in.
It's right there.
Yeah.
I speak to him at least once a month to this day. Yeah, well, great story. I was at home on a Friday out in Long Island. Beautiful day at my pool. A lawyer from LA, a friend of mine, no longer with us, unfortunately, Peter Lopez, called me and said, you know, I've got this white rapper. I'm about to make a deal with Atlantic Records, but they're giving me a hard time on some of the terms and conditions. Would you be interested in listening to it? And I said, of course, Peter. Peter had brought me Wilson Phillips, and he was their lawyer. I signed Wilson Phillips, and of course you know how successful they were. And so he played it for me over the phone. He played me Ice Ice Baby. And it was already on a small independent label out of Texas. And he said to me that, you know, would I be interested? And I said, what are the issues you're having with Atlantic Records? And he told me a couple of the issues that he was having. I said, none of those are issues for me. I had just formed SBK Records. Whenever the video arrived, I was at my house, outside. I had friends over, I had a lot of kids over, and I put on the CD of Ice Ice Baby. I had already looked at the video, and you know, you looked at the video, the guy was incredibly handsome and charismatic.
Great so dancer.
That passed the test. I then played the song about 20 times in a row, you know, for all these little kids that were there who all loved it and were singing it after the fifth, you know, song. And of course, I called Peter and I said, I saw the video, we're done. We're in business. And that was the beginning of Vanilla Ice.
He has a big personality. Tracy Chapman has a personality, has something to say. There's a message and a meaning. What do you think about personality? Like the people you've worked with from Diana Ross and Barbara Streisand.
Don't bring around a clown. What I want, I know how.
These aren't just average, everyday people. These are people that really have big personalities.
Yeah,
Mr.
Well,
Sinatra.
I want to wake up in a city that never sleeps.
Of course, the Beatles.
Well, they are. The fact that they have these big personalities, or that they're as unique as they are, is the reason that we're talking about them now, many years after their initial success. So sometimes, you know, I would gravitate to what my ear liked before discovering the personality. So of course, when I met Diana Ross, she was Diana Ross. So when I met Barbara and realized and made her understand that she was the same age as Neil Diamond or Joni Mitchell, yet she was in a music time warp, because that's what she loved. I had to introduce it to contemporary music.
What do you? Could you isolate a skill if you had to? Like if you were going to help someone or try to teach someone, is there a skill that you would highlight?
You got a fast car. I got a plan to get us out of here. Been working at the convenience store. Managed to save just a little bit of money. Won't have to drive too far. Cross the border and into the city. You and I can both get jobs.
What do you, could you isolate a skill if you had to? Like if you were going to help someone or try to teach someone, is there a skill that you would highlight?
You know, I think one of the things that I've been able to do is learn how to tell people the truth. That to me is a you know, kind of a fail-safe for success in whatever arena you're dealing with.
So you're really getting involved in people's lives.
Yeah, you know, I'm a little bit of a fixer, if you will. As the years go on and you get, you know, older and hopefully wiser, you build a lot of relationships.
But you also know the value of relationships.
I do. Relationships are very important.
Yeah. That's the, you obviously have cultivated right. that like no other. I think particularly in this business, meaning all of entertainment, it's predicated on this idea that everybody takes care of or is nice and wants to be gentle to artists and they don't want to tell them the truth. So the biggest thing, I have the same epiphany X amount of years ago that you're talking about right now, which is if I'm working with talent, I just find the nicest way possible to tell them, this isn't really work. You're not that great. Like, this isn't working.
Well, because at the end of the day, they're going to find that out. I mean, you know, the truth shows up either on time, early, or late. But at some point, the truth turns up. So why make it difficult?
Talk to me about who you're working with.
Well, you know, Mark Anthony is, I always believed he was the... to this day, that he's kind of the Latin Sinatra. He's got the same swagger, the same style, in a Latin version. And I've known him for quite some time. And for the most part, I've been lucky enough that I answer every call,
yeah,
and they're mostly incoming calls.
So that's your secret. See, you pick up the phone.
I do. I answer every email as quickly as I, you know, as quickly as I can.
Nicki's, no one's bigger than Nicki Minaj right now.
Yeah, I mean, Nicki again, unique, special, has a very clear picture of who she is and what she is and what she wants to be.
Now I'm interested. I came up on the Beast. I had the 45s from Def Jam before Beastie Boys did. License to Ill.
Again,
a huge fan.
It'll be in my book. One of my daughters, Sweet 16, I wanted Run DMC to perform. Called their manager. He said, no problem, we'll be happy to do it for you. But I want you to also have this new group called the Beastie Boys. On the night of the event, you know, a long stretch limo shows up at my house, and out come the Beastie Boys, and I had security, etc. So I leave, and we have this big party going on. And one of my security guys comes to me and he said, you know, Mr. Koppelman, we just caught the Beastie Boys, these guys, they were rummaging through your house, grabbing all kinds of stuff.
So I go
back into the room and I said, guys, this is one you're going to tell everybody. This is going to be great for your career. I said, you're going to tell everybody that Charles Koppelman threw you out of his house. Fast forward 2.5 years later. I'm sitting at the Grammys. Tracy Chapman's up for 5 different Grammy Awards. I'm in like the first row, watching the show, and I feel something hit the back of my head. And I turn around, and it's a spitball that the Beastie Boys were shooting at me. So I get up and I turn around, and now they were the Beastie Boys.
Yes.
And they looked at me and they said, you were right. It was the best thing that you ever did for us. And then, of course, they were on Capitol Records,
right,
which I then took over, and they became friends of mine.
So you still ended up their boss.
Yeah. How cool is that?
Very cool. What advice do you give so people see these stars at this level, like somebody just starting out? How do you tell someone, how do you make money in this business, in entertainment? Is there any advice that you...
Well, you know, if they're special, they're going to make money. I mean, obviously, the dynamics today of a recording artist has changed significantly, which is why so many of them are looking to have brand extensions. That's a way to make the kind of money that you used to make as a recording artist. You go out and perform. There are more artists performing today than ever before. They do more shows. There's an appetite from the audience because of social media.
Yep.
You're able to spread the word that they're going to show up, and where are they going to be, and when are they going to be there. You're able to communicate. So that's another arena where an artist can can
them make connecting a with lot their of audience money is big.
And connect, you know, that connection is very, that personal connection is very important. And music artists have that personal connection. And if you can then figure out how to be honest with your constituency and monetize that, you're building a real business.
Amazing.
Yep.
Charles, all very all amazing. Real. Thank you, Charles.
My pleasure.
I appreciate it.
Thanks.